Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our current affairs. So today you have 21st of April 2021, as you know, and these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC as well as other government competitive examinations, right? And for that purpose, you are probably studying the national newspapers like The Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers for your preparation. You can supplement your preparation also with the help of these lectures, which are uploaded on YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, right, where you will get the daily current affairs based these lectures. All right, so you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is about the US currency watch list. See, the US currency watch list is being basically is being made by the US Treasury Department. Now in that watch list, what happens is the United States Treasury Department would put certain countries on the watch list for the currency manipulations, right? If any particular country or if any particular country's central bank, if they are involved in the currency manipulations, in the sense is if they are involved in some sort of a accumulation of the forex or accumulation of the dollars or some sort of a extra manipulation that basically impact the free flow of the currency, that type of manipulations, then the US currency or US Treasury Department would put that country, right, in the currency watch list, right? In that watch list, the US may put further sanction or may put certain restrictions on the country. So here the US has kept, right, India on the watch list for the currency manipulators, right? And in that reply, the Union Commerce Secretary, the India's Union Commerce Secretary has questioned the rationale behind putting India into the watch list for the currency manipulators. The Union Commerce Secretary very clearly says that it is simply intrusion into the policy sphere, right, of a particular country, of a particular bank, right, around the world, because all such the manipulation that have been said by the US Department of the Treasury, right, is simply the intrusion into the space that has been given to the banks for the purpose of meeting their mandate, right? This is all thing is doing by the central banks in order to stabilize, right, maybe your exchange rate, maybe your some sort of a the market rates. So but that putting into the watch list, that is simply intrusion. So this watch list have made by the US Treasury Department, which has recently retained India into the watch list for the currency manipulators, right? And this list have been submitted to the US Congress. The US Congress is just like the Indian Parliament. The Congress in the US has two houses, again, the lower house and the upper house, right? And the US Treasury Department basically hold that the India is involved higher dollar purchase that is close to the 5% of the GDP or gross domestic product. So the US Treasury Department has clearly says that the India has committed or the central bank has committed the higher amount of dollar purchase that is to close of 5% of the GDP, right, by definitely by the central bank. So that is something is, according to the US Treasury Department, it's a manipulations on the currency. The another the assumption that have been taken by the US Treasury Department is the currency watch list is that the India has currently the surplus of around 20 billion or more. So that surplus does not require the currency to be accumulate over the period of the time. So that data, if you see the India surplus to the US, right, if you see that data from 2020-21 and 2019-20, if you see these 2 years data, right, in the two financial years data, what you would find is that in 2019-20 it was $18 billion. It was a trade surplus that India has with the US. Okay, in 2020-21, the India has a trade surplus of around 23 billion. So that means if you see 5 billion more, that India surplus has grown from 2019-20 to 2020-21. Currently, the India surplus is $23 billion, right? So that is very high. And why this surplus is there? Why this trade surplus is there? Because in the trade you will see basically export and import. So what happens is, due to the COVID-19 or due to the coronavirus, what happens is that India's import fell down more sharply. So because there was no demand in the market, specifically in India, so that import was basically fall down, but the export remains same, or export remains unaffected. So that is the reason the India got the trade surplus of around $23 billion, right? And in response to definitely to the US move, this US move of putting India into the watch list, right? The India has very clearly says that the RBI or Reserve Bank of India or the Central Bank of India is basically taking all necessary steps in order to maintain the stability in the financial markets, right? And India is not, you know, doing something that is to accumulating the forex reserve that has been done by the China. The China has, you know, trillions of the dollars that have been accumulated by the China in the past. So, you know, the India clearly says that India is not involved in accumulation of the forex like the China that has been done in the past. Okay. It is simply a mandate which is given to the Reserve Bank of India or the Central Bank, definitely to provide the stability in the currency market, right? So the RBI is doing basically its own mandate, which has been given by the law, and the RBI basically generally does with the help of the buy and the selling of the foreign currency in order to maintain the liquidity in the market, right? So that is basically to stabilize the currency, right? That all the activities will be done by the RBI. And India also says that our overall reserve have been fairly steady at around $500 billion to $600 billion. So that is fairly steady. We have not, you know, increased, or we have not spiked our this reserve that has been there in terms of the dollars. How you can say that we are accumulating your foreign currency in terms of dollar, right? We are not accumulating the reserves like the China, which have already accumulated at one point of the time. That accumulated reserve in the China is around $4 trillion. 4 trillion. You can assume that much forex have been reserved in the China, right? That accumulation was done by the China, that is to be illegally. Okay. So here he is basically our Commerce Secretary, Mr. Anup Badhwan, who has clearly says that the central bank activity in the foreign exchange market is completely balanced, right, and completely legitimate within the accepted monetary policy mandate which have been provided, right, to the central bank across the world. And this watch list is simply an intrusion, right, into the domain of that central banks, and that intrusion into the policy space of the central bank is simply unacceptable, right, in India as well as in other countries which have been kept in this watch list of the currency manipulators. All right, so this is what is the news, our first news. Second, the Bangalore Metro Rail project phase 2A and phase 2B. So as you know that the Bangalore is basically, you know, basically a city, right? So here the Metro Rail development project is already underway. So for phase 2A and for phase 2B, the Union Cabinet has approved, right, you know, these two phases, you know, that has to be, you know, constructed over the period of the time. So the Union Cabinet has approved the phase 2A, that is from Chennai Silk Road Junction to KRpuram. These are the two major spots in between. These phase 2A will be constructed, and in phase 2B, that is from KRpuram to, you know, basically airport, that will be passed through the Hebbal Junction. So these two phases, that is 2A and 2B, will be constructed, and that total length would be around 58.19 kilometers. The total investment or total cost for this completion of the project would be around 14,788 crore rupees. Okay, now with that approval of the Union Cabinet for the construction of this phase 2, right, the project would definitely streamline the urban transportation system, because as you know, in the Bangalore, which is also a metro city, have these very congested urban transportation system that has been not as per with the requirement of the demand. Okay, so definitely we need basically some sort of the intensive development, right, that is basically going on in terms of all urban cities, in all metro cities. So we need to increase some sort of optimization in terms of urban transportation system. This transportation system should be efficiently, should be well connected to the people, right? Because nowadays the people are resorted to use their own private vehicles. There is, you know, heavy congestion on the roads, right? Obviously putting stress on the travel infrastructure very high. So that is basically to relieve that, you know, the pressure. The efficient urban transportation system is the way to relieve that pressure on the roads. Okay, so this metro project itself is an innovation over the conventional system of urban transport that we have. For example, if you go to Chennai, first of all, there you will find basically the local trains. These local trains, just like, you know, the Mumbai local trains, they used to run from one spot to the another spot. And now the Chennai and the Mumbai both are having basically the metro connectivity also. So they are having the dual urban transportation. The local trains are also there, metro trains are also there, you know, public transportation buses are also there, right? Still the roads are very congested. That is all things happens due to the overpopulation in the cities. Okay, so this project basically involved the integration with other urban transportation system, definitely, which has been available. Just now I have explained you the local trains, buses and other, you know, that has led to, you know, some sort of a, you know, coordination among them, so that it makes an efficient and effective manner wherever it is possible, by designing, by technological advancement, by institutional management, so that the urban transportation management can be tackled with a efficient manner. Okay, so you can see here the Bangalore metro rail, which is being basically constructed in the Bangalore. Okay, next, finance bill 2021. Now the news related to the finance bill, I'll explain you what is finance bill a little bit later. So first of all, let's understand the news. What is the news? The Union Cabinet has given ex post facto approval, okay, for the government amendment to the finance bill. Ex post facto means after passing that one, right? So that is, you have given some sort of a, you know, the advance approval for the government amendment to the finance bill 2021 that was already enacted on 2021, right? As a finance act 2021. Now, what is this finance bill? First of all, see, finance bill that you say is that it's simply a form a part of union budget, right? It's a part of union budget. The finance bill basically details about, you know, all legal amendments that is required for the changes in the taxation, right, which is proposed by the finance minister of the country. For example, our honorable finance minister is Miss Nirmala Sitharaman, who have proposed certain, amendment that is required to be, you know, changes in the taxation that is proposed by any sort of a government, say finance minister. Okay, so what you can say is that regarding finance budget or finance bill, the finance bill is nothing but a bill, okay, that as the name suggests, it is a concern about the country's finance. What is that? So the country's finance, that could be, you know, your taxes, government expenditure or government borrowings or even revenue, right? So since union budget deals with all such things, it is passed as a finance bill because it is a part of your budget. So definitely these amendments which have been, you know, given ex post facto approval by the government, right? So that is basically essentially to clarify and rationalize the proposals that has been made and to address the stakeholders' concern arising out of the amendment that has been proposed in the finance bill. So that ex post facto approval that has given to the finance bill that has already been passed in the March, right? So that is something to be understood in that respect. So the government amendment to the finance bill 2021 shall provide, you know, various other avenues. For example, it will provide the equity and inclusiveness to the taxpayers, right? How it will provide the equity and inclusiveness? Because it will address all sort of a concern regarding the stakeholders, right? Definitely with respect to the amendment that has been proposed. And the government amend to the finance bill that has been related to the tax proposals, right? Because all such tax proposals are basically going to generate the revenue that will be beneficial to the government, obviously, and that will streamline the existing provisions of addressing grievance to the taxpayers also, because not only the government has the responsibility of generating the revenue, but also the government has responsibility of addressing all outstanding grievances that are related to the taxpayers also. So all such things needed certain amendment in the finance bill, and for that purpose the amendment have been ex post facto approved by the Union Cabinet. All right. Next, the Talcher Fertilizers Limited. See, Talcher Fertilizers Limited is basically, let me first give you a brief outline about the Talcher Fertilizers Limited, then we'll move. Okay, so Talcher Fertilizers Limited is a basically a joint venture company. Joint venture company means where you will have more than two stakeholders, or at least two stakeholders are there, right, for the formation of this company. So it's a joint venture company, which is promoted by GAIL, right, which is promoted by CIL. So the stakeholders basically are GAIL, CIL, that is Coal India Limited, then RCF. RCF means Rashtriya Chemicals and Fertilizers Limited. Then you have FCIL, that is basically Fertilizers Corporation of India Limited. So these four PSUs are involved basically to revive the FCIS Talcher Fertilizer Unit in Angul district of Orissa. So right, so a joint venture company have been set up for the purpose of, right, for the purpose of reviving the FCIL Talcher Fertilizer Plant, which is basically, you know, the Fertilizers Corporation of India's the Talcher Fertilizer Plant, right? It has been located in the Angul district of Orissa. So what is the stake currently? Currently GAIL Coal India Limited, GAIL Coal India Limited and RCF, that is your Rashtriya Chemicals and Fertilizers Limited, all three having the stake in this joint venture, that is around 31.85%. Right, so all three PSUs are having the stake of around 38.85%. Okay, in this, and that is each one. So GAIL having 31.85, CIL having 31.85, and RCF 31.85. So each one is having 31.85% of stake. So, and FCIL is having the remaining, that is 4.45% of stake. It was currently owned by, you know, FCIL. Now it has been made a joint venture company. So here you can roughly estimate 31 plus 31 plus 31, roughly around 95 point something, and remaining is basically 4.45 is basically held by the FCIL. The company basically plans to produce around 1.26 MMTPA, that is million metric tons per annum. So MMTPA is million metric tons per annum. So it is the estimated, you know, the production that will be getting after being, you know, reviving, after being revived completely with the help of this joint venture. So what happens is the Union Cabinet has given approval for the proposal of the Department of Fertilizer for the formulation of this subsidy policy for the urea, because the urea is a fertilizer which have been used extensively by our farmers. So a subsidy policy for the urea is basically very important. Now this urea can be manufactured, first of all, with various process. Now this Talcher fertilizer plant would use the coal gasification route. That means it will use the technology that is called coal gasification technology, right? With the help of the Talcher Fertilizers Limited would aim at the generation of, or would aim at the production of 1.26 million metric tons per annum of urea production with the help of the coal gasification technology. All right. So here, considering this strategic energy security and urea self-sufficiency, because this is also for the strategic purpose, and it is also for the self-sufficiency, right, in terms of the production of urea. Definitely, the India has also its vast coal reserves also. Now, the India has coal reserves, vast coal reserves, and India is able to produce the urea, that is to fulfill the self, you know, the self need of the country, right? It is also considered a strategic energy security project, and that is why it has been decided by the government of India to go ahead with the revival of Talcher Fertilizers, you know, limited plant based on the coal gasification technology. So I hope it is clear. Okay, now you can understand also, the project shall improve the availability of the fertilizer, that is specifically urea, to the farmers. Thereby, what will it boost? It will boost development, it will boost industrial production, it will boost the agricultural production, it will definitely cost, save, you know, some sort of a transport subsidy for the supply of the urea, specifically into the eastern part of the country. So what this Talcher, you know, plant is going to have, the Talcher plant shall employ the coal gasification technology for the production of urea, right? And that will have the estimated cost of around 13,270 crore rupees, right? That will be the estimated cost for the product, for the revival of that one. Okay. And Talcher Fertilizer Limited is basically have been allotted the northern part of North Arkpal coal mine. The North Arkpal coal mine belongs to the Coal India Limited for its feedstock needs. That means the Coal India Limited would provide them the coal for the coal gasification technology, right? And in that purpose, the project is targeted to be completion by 2023-24. All right. And so definitely it will assist to reduce the urea imports that is currently to the tune of around 12.7 lakh metric tons. That is lakh metric tons per annum. So India is currently importing 12.7 lakh metric tons per annum of urea. So considering that the objective of this project, the project would lead to the development of around 1.26 million metric tons per annum of urea. That will be the capacity after once it is fully operationalized. All right. Next, the India-Bangladesh MOU on establishment of a framework of cooperation, right, in the area of trade remedial measures. So it is simply an MOU, that is Memorandum of Understanding, that has been signed between India and the Bangladesh, first of all. And this MOU basically provides a framework of cooperation specifically in the trade remedial measures, right? So what is that MOU? So first of all, the Union Cabinet has given the approval, right, for that MOU. This MOU was signed basically, you know, at Dhaka, right, which is the capital of Bangladesh. It has been signed between the Director General of Trade Remedies of India as well as the Bangladesh Trade and Tariff Commission of Bangladesh, right? It has been signed, right, to provide a framework of the cooperation in the area of the trade remedial measures. So what is that all about? The primary objective of this MOU in the field of the trade remedial measures is it will provide some sort of a framework, right, to based on which the both of the countries can cooperate and remove all sort of a, you know, the trade related the conflicts between the two countries, and so that the trade remedial measures can be put in, right? So that will provide, you know, broad activities related to the exchange of information between the two countries, right? This MOU would also provide the, you know, some sort of a capacity building initiatives between the two countries, right? And this MOU would also be in accordance with the provisions of World Trade Organization, specifically with respect to the anti-dumping duties or anti-dumping measures, countervailing duties, and safeguarding definitely the bilateral trade between India and the Bangladesh. Okay, and this MOU would further seeks the cooperation between, you know, definitely, you know, relevant authority between India and Bangladesh, definitely to discourage some sort of a unfair trade practices that is been currently going on, and to promote the rule-based bilateral trading system between the two countries in order to boost the bilateral trade between the two countries. Okay, so it is basically a political map. You can see here the Bangladesh, which is also bordered with, you know, India. And you have basically Delta, which is the world largest delta, which is also formed at the Bay of Bengal. Okay. Next, you have CZAC Republic. So first of all, the CZAC Republic, there is, why the CZAC Republic is in the news? The CZAC Republic is in the news because it has in the conflict with the Russia. So CZAC Republic is first of all a part of the Central Europe. It is a part of Central Europe. It is a country. It is an independent country. So what happens is the CZAC Republic, right, is claiming that the Russian diplomats or the diplomats which are belongs to the Russia are basically some sort of a, you know, spies, or they are the intelligence officers. They are collecting vital information from the CZAC Republic, right, as well as they are also involved in the armed depot explosion, right? In that armed depot explosion in 2014, two person was died. So the, what happens is, with that allegations, the CZAC Republic expelled 18 Russian diplomats from the country, completely expelled, right? These 18 Russian diplomats belong to Russia. And now what happens is, it is for the tit for the tat, the Russia also sent back the 20 CZAC diplomats which has been there in the Russia. Now what happens is, with the expelling of each other's diplomats, the relationship between the two countries have now been strained and now been tensed, right? So the Paraguay also accused, you know, the Russian embassy officials of being an intelligence operatives. They are basically involved in some sort of snoofing or some sort of spying activities, and they are also involved in the explosion at the armed depot where the 2 person was died in 2014. Okay, so Czech Republic is basically a landlocked country. Landlocked country means you don't have the access to the water, right? And moreover, it is completely landlocked. That means there is no some sort of a the exit, otherwise it is being connected with the neighboring country. So it is completely landlocked, no water bodies. It is basically lying in the Central Europe, and if you see the political map, it is bordered by Austria to the south, it is bordered with Germany to the west, it has been bordered to the Poland to the northeast, and Slovakia to the east, and its capital is Prague, right? Which is also the largest city in the Czech Republic. Okay, now let's understand the history of the Czech Republic. So first of all, in the 19th century, the Czech was also involved in the First World War, right? The Czech lands become more industrialized, specifically in the 19th century, because of industrial revolution. In 1918, when the World War was basically started. Now what happens is, World War was ended at that point of the time. The First World War was started in 1914 to 1918. So by 1918, most part of the first, right, Slovak Republic, right, which basically formed the collapse of Austria-Hungary after First World War, have become the industrialized, part. Now, that was after the Munich Agreement in the 1938, right? The Nazi Germany, that was led by the Hitler, systematically took control over the Czech land that was basically industrialized after the First World War. Now what happens is, this Czechoslovakia was basically restored in 1945, and that became the Eastern Bloc communist state. That means it followed the communist ideology following the coup in 1948. And what happens in November 1989, recently, the Velvet Revolution basically ended the communist rule. Now it was a communist bloc, or it was a communist state, right? Basically following a coup that in 1948, and it has become a communist state, and it was a communist country since 1948 to 1989. And after that, there was a Velvet Revolution, which has ended this communist party rule in the country. Now on 1st January 1993, the Czechoslovakia basically dissolved in its constituent states and becoming the independent states of the Czech Republic and Slovakia, and that has basically ultimately formed the non-communist state in the Central Europe. Okay, so here you can see, here you have the Czech Republic, which is the capital of Paraguay. The other neighboring country, you have the Poland, Germany, Austria, Slovakia, and the Hungary, which are basically some of the neighboring country of Czech Republic. Okay, next is fusion peptide, right? So what is fusion peptide? The fusion peptide, you can see, it is basically the virus spike protein, right, where the virus can basically attach. So what happens is, as you know, that because of the mutation, the virus has become more contagious. The vaccines, or available vaccines which are available in the world, now they become ineffective for the new mutant strain of the virus. Now what happens is, a new platform, the scientists basically have developed a new vaccine, right, that is COVID-19 vaccine, that would say that it will provide protection against not only the existing but also any future strain that has been related to the SARS-CoV coronavirus. So the new vaccine, which has been developed by the scientists, that will be effective not only to the current strain of coronavirus, but it also effective to the any future strain of the coronavirus, including the mutant form also. So this new vaccine production platform was basically invented by Dr. Stephen L. Zenner, which is basically, you know, a professor with the University of Virginia Health System. Okay, and it basically involved, or synthesizing of this vaccine involved, you know, the synthesizing of DNA, that direct production of the pieces of the viruses. right? So what this vaccine would do, the vaccine would instruct the immune system of a particular person, right, to mount an immune response against that virus, okay? And here, the vaccine basically generally targets a part of the virus spike protein that is called the fusion peptide, okay? And this compound is basically essentially a universal among the coronavirus and has not been observed to differ it at all genetic sequences of the SARS-CoV virus, which has been obtained around the world. So most of the vaccine which has been developed, right, in the recent time have been targeting either the entire spike protein or just a receptor binding domain of a virus, right? Now these antibodies which have been developed against this receptor binding domain can provide a good neutralizing activity, and that can be the mutations in the receptor binding protein, right, and that will decrease somewhat effectiveness of the antibodies as per, you know, the scientists which have claimed, you know, after forming this the new vaccine for controlling this coronavirus in the world. Okay, next, demographic advantage. As you know about demographic advantage, what is the demographic advantage? The India has in the demographic advantage. What is in the demographic advantage means, because India has the more population in the working category or in the basically in the youth population. So that is that provides India a demographic advantage. And India is also in the demographic transition to convert its the demographic, the population to demographic advantage, right? So a study which is conducted by the China's central bank, right, which is also in the report, says that the India's demographic advantage will take over the China by 2035. So this advantage will take over the China by 2035. And here, because of the China's policy, also related to, you know, controlling the birth, specifically the one child policy, has led to the alarming situation in the China. So what is happening? First of all, there is a situation like aging population in the China. Okay, there is a dwindling workforce because one child policy has led to the reduction of the workforce, specifically the youth population, because if you just restrict to the one child, definitely the youth population will decline over the period of the time. So dwindling workforce will be the natural outcome of that, the less, the youth population, as well as it will also promote the aging of the population, because whatever the population that will have, if you have the improved medical facility, definitely aging of the population will be the definite outcome of that. Okay. Now, this report is basically released by the People's Bank of China. This clearly says that the China should immediately liberalize its birth policies. Liberalizing birth policy means from, rather than restricting the world child, right, the China should, adopt a policy that should promote the birth to the babies, right, in order to tackle the problems like aging of the population, or, to plan to compete economically demographic young population, that is basically India, or with respect to the US, which is a immigration friendly country. So in order to compete with these two countries like India and the US, the India which is a demographically young country and US which is basically the immigration friendly country, in order to compete with the two countries, the People's Bank of China basically in its study clearly says that the China should, liberalize birth control policy in order to compete with these two countries, right? So in a detailed section on India, the banks basically, reported that the gap between the two countries is narrowing in terms of the demography, right? If you see that, the report further says that in the Asia, the two largest countries in terms of the population is India and the China. And the China's economic growth is much faster than India for a longer time. But what is happening that the China's People's Bank basically says that recent years, the China's demographic dividend is fading because of one child policy. And now economic growth, or India's economic growth, has now been, is going to approach the China's economic growth. So that, the gap is also been falling. And in terms of the China's aging population, right, in terms of the declining birth rate, right, for the China, the bank further, or in the bank's report further, states that this type of situation would be more serious in the next 10 years, right? So in the next 10 years, that means by 2031, the China will have very serious problems in terms of its working population that will be dwindling, in terms of its aging population that will be increasing further, and the India's demographic structure would definitely provide an advantage to the India that would be further optimized, right? And that will further strengthen the economic growth of India. Okay, this report further says that the India's labor force would exceed the China's labor force by hundreds of millions, right, in the years ahead. That means the India's workforce would be much higher in terms of hundreds of the millions, right, as compared to the China. And by 2050, even this advantage would continue to grow in terms of having higher, you know, the labor force in basically India than to China. And the India will have the narrowly elder population, right? That is because, you know, the India has not, first of all, have had this type of one child policy, right? And India will have also the wider workforce in the middle, and India will also have the wider workforce at the bottom, right? So that report further says that indicate that India will have the abundant workforce, right, even beyond 2050, and that will promise the India's growth potential even beyond 2050. But the China will not have that type of advantage, just like India, beyond 2050, as reported by the People's Bank of China. Okay. Next. The cabinet approved MOU between CCI and CAD. What is CCI, first of all? See, CCI is basically Competition Commission of India. What is Competition Commission of India? See, Competition Commission of India is basically a competition regulator in India. It is a competition regulator in India. Now, what is that? It is a statutory body. Statutory body means it has been created after a law which has been passed in the parliament. So, it is a statutory body of the government of India, which is a competition regulator for enforcing the Competition Act 2002. Competition Act 2002, which was the main statutory provision under which the Competition Commission of India was basically set up. Right? Now, the main purpose is to promote the competition throughout the India and to prevent activities that can have the appreciable adverse impact on the competition in India, right? That is the Competition Commission of India. What is Administrative Council for Economic Defense of Brazil? That is called CED. So Administrative Council for the Economic Defense of Brazil is a national competition regulator and the agency of government of Brazil. It is a similar agency with respect to the Competition Commission of India, which is lying in India. This agency is basically a competition regulator, and the agency lies with the government of Brazil. So what happens is the MOU which was signed between Competition Commission of India and CED, that is basically approved by the Union Cabinet. Now, the Competition Commission of India or the Competition Act 2002 basically permits under Section 18, right, the Competition Commission of India to enter into any memorandum of agreement or any agreement with any agency, right, even with the foreign country, for the purpose of discharging its duties or for the performance of its functions, in order to, you know, promote the competition throughout the India and also to prevent the activities that can have, you know, the appreciable adverse impact on the competition in India. So the Competition Commission of India has entered an MOU with the Federal Trade Commission and the Department of Justice of the USA. In that mandate, it has also entered into the MOU with Director General Competition of European Union. It has also entered into the MOU with the Federal Anti-Monopoly Services of Russia. It has also entered with the MOU with the Australian Competition and the Consumer Commission. The Competition Commission of India has also entered into the MOU with the Competition Bureau of Canada and also the BRICS competition authorities, definitely to promote the competition throughout the country as well as to prevent activities that can have the adverse impact of the competition. Okay. So here the Brazil, which is the capital of Brasilia. Okay. Next, you have the Startup India Seed Fund Scheme. What is that Startup India Seed Fund Scheme? See, the startups means through this seed fund scheme, the startup in the country will be promoted. So startups is basically any sort of a business that will be, or any sort of a, you know, the entrepreneurship that will be started with the help of these startups, and for that purpose the funds will be provided. So it is a Startup India Seed Fund Scheme for the purpose of their establishment. So here the Commerce and the Industry Minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, has announced the Startup India Seed Fund scheme, right? This fund scheme would aims to provide the financial assistance to the startups. That is basically specifically, right, startup, right, for the proof of the prototype development, for the product trial, for the market entry, for the commercialization of the product, for the proof of the concept. For that purpose, the funds will be provided through this, the fund scheme. Now, an estimated amount of 945 crore rupees have been divided over next 4 years that will be provided as a seed funding, right, definitely to the eligible startups, definitely through the eligible incubators across the country. Okay, now this scheme is definitely expected to support around 3600 startups with the help of 300 incubators, and this funding will be provided through these incubators. Okay, and this scheme would secure the seed funding, right? It will also inspire the innovation, it will support the transformative ideas, it will facilitate the implementation, it will also start the startup revolution in the country that will be beneficial for the longer run in terms of the economic development. And the scheme will create the robust startup ecosystem in our country, particularly in the tier 2 and tier 3 towns of India, because such type of towns will require the industrial development, the industrial revolution, right? And for that purpose, the robust startup ecosystem will definitely help in tier 2 and tier 3 towns of our country, and that are basically deprived of adequate funding, specifically in those towns. So that will be helping in that. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.